各位，我哋帮
members may I call to order meeting of the security panel. It is a little bit late already, and we've formed a quorum. Today's meeting has been extended by 1 hour until 5:30 p.m. Because next month, well, we've been reminded by the Secretariat that due to council sittings, there's a likelihood that our panel cannot meet again next month, so I've decided to extend the meeting by 1 hour. Since the last meeting, 4 information papers have been issued, and we have asked the administration to respond. And so far, 3 have been responded, with the exception of Mr. WONG Yuk-man. So members can comment if you have questions on these information papers. The item coming up next is construction of staff quarters for Correctional Services Department at Tin Wan Aberdeen. Please invite the administration to join us. For this part of the meeting, we have Mr. John Lee, Undersecretary for Security, Mr. Alex Chen, PAS for Security, Ms. Ng Sao Wai, Assistant Commissioner of Correctional Services, Mr. Chen Pak Cheung, Senior Project Manager from ASD and also from the same department, Mr. Chen Fat Yao, Chief Project Manager, as well as Ms. Ginger Yang, District Planning Officer from the Planning Department. Welcome. They are here to discuss with us this paper on the construction of quarters for the CSD. Paper CB 1381/08. May I remind members that if you have a direct pecuniary interest, either direct or indirect, involved, please declare the nature of this interest before you speak. Right. Can I invite the Undersecretary to walk us through the paper first? Thank you. Chairman, the government's policy is to provide quarters for eligible civil servants, unmarried civil servants, and members from the disciplined services in particular, to take care of their needs and to maintain morale. There are about 2,400-odd officers in the CSD eligible for quarters. However, only 2,000-odd units are available, and the shortage is is about 13.7%, and the average waiting time is about 4 years. To alleviate this burden or this pressure on our supply of quarters, we've proposed to build a 16-story quarters block providing 70 DQ units in Tin Wan Aberdeen. With members' approval, we intend to start in the last quarter of this year for completion ASAP. The old building has already been pulled down to maximize the plot ratio. We've applied to the town planning board with approval granted in January this year, so that the plot ratio will be relaxed. So instead of 13 stories, we can have 16 stories built here to maximize the potential of the site. We consulted the district Development and Housing Committee of the Southern District in February this year, and members of the committee had no objection. We hope that the panel can support our proposal so that we can apply for funding from the PWSC and FC respectively. Thank you. How many members are going to speak on this item, please? A show of hands, please. All right, I'll read out the names. Mr. Chen Kam Lam, Mr. Ma Fong Kwok, Ms. Sid Ho, Mr. Tong Li Zi, Mr. Paul Zi, Mr. Long Kwok Hong. Have I, Mr. Annie? Any more? No? We have six members. 3 minutes each, okay? Mr. Chang Kam Lam. Thank you, Chairman. In principle, we support the redevelopment project. However, even if the block is completed, there are only 100 or so units. So, this is hardly sufficient for CSD officers waiting for quarters. I'd like to know whether the administration will continue to identify possible sites, because is quite often that you redevelop ex-housing department staff quarters. Will there be new sites available, although they may be rather remote, but that's still better than nothing? Otherwise, they may have to compete for resources with other disciplined services. So, do you have plans to increase the supply of sites for construction of quarters? Undersecretary. Thank you, Chairman, and thank you, Mr. Chen. The Security Bureau has got 8 projects in the pipeline involving quarters for different discipline services, and they will provide over 2,000 units. There are 3 projects already approved by the Finance Committee, and this is the 4th one. Because the Security Bureau understands the pressure for more staff quarters from different disciplined services, and we're trying very hard to relieve that pressure. FC has already approved 3 projects involving 1 for rank and file officers of the Customs and Excise, another one for Immigration Department at Lok Fu, and in Kwun Tong we have complex for different disciplined services. And the 4th will be the staff quarters for CSD at Tin Wan. We have 4 more in the pipeline. In Zhang Guanong, we will have a project for Customs and Excise at Fan Yun, a rank and file staff quarters for the police, and also 5 services, Pak Shing Kok, and also another one at Chiwan Shan for the Customs and Excise. So we do understand the demand for staff quarters, and we are allocating our resources following these principles.
As for the policy principle, the site, the land, will come from each of the disciplinary forces, their own land allotted to them, and we will develop from there on. But of course, we will also allow for applications to the government. Mr. Ma Fong Kwok and then Sit Ho. Yes, Mr. Chair, I would want to support that we provide quarters to the members of the disciplinary forces with the need, but I do not understand the figures. Now, say there are 70 units, and the total is 256 million Hong Kong dollars. Now, this is including furniture, and the per unit or per square meter is some 70 $1,000, and which means 3.6 million per unit. Now, I'm looking at the construction cost on average for Hong Kong. This tends to be high. Why is it? Why is this? I see that there's only but one multi-purpose function room, and then there is a disabled car park, etc. But why would the construction cost be so high, given that there are not too many facilities? The Architectural Services Department. Yes, Mr. Chair, the construction cost is affected by the conditions of the site itself. The site itself is 721 square meters, and we are to provide 70 quarter units within this area. This area of the site is relatively small, and this affects the tendering cost. As the contractors put in their tenders, they will take into consideration their fixed cost, and in their tender, the fixed cost proportion would become higher as a ratio. For instance, the site office of the contractor, given that the site area itself is small, the contractor in the tendering bid will have to consider rentals in the neighboring area to house its site office. As for storage of materials, as an other example, because of the limitation of the site area, materials will also have to be stored outside of the site area, so there will be rentals considerations as well. These costs all impact the tendering cost. I do not accept the reasons that you have mentioned. In the urban area, there are even smaller sites. But of course, there are bigger sites. But from my understanding, the construction cost is not as high. How do they do it? I mean, it's the same construction contractors, are they not? I really don't understand still. Mr. Chan?
Yes, Mr. Chair. There are certain characteristics to this site. For instance, in the Tin Wan Hill Road side of the site, there are slopes. And in our design phase, we have referred to the land department to request for a retaining wall be put in for the slope.
Yes. Well, I hope the Public Works will look into this further. Again, if you can look into the construction cost, because indeed it is high.
Sit-ho?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. I'm looking at paragraph 8 there. It says in the footnote, let's say per unit flat is about 50 meters square, and that means 500 square feet or so. And it says that the annual recurrent expenditure of the project is about 5.3 million, which means 6,309 Hong Kong dollars per flat, which is high. Even private sector flats would not have a monthly management fee amounting to, what, 6,309. Now, if you say that you're giving it some room for maneuver, then give us a more realistic figure coming back with the next round of meeting. For the typo youth hostel, even though it is a lot bigger in site and in the number of units, the annual management fee is but 1.8 million.
John Lee?
Yes, Mr. Chair. I would agree that when it comes to the Public Works Committee, there will be detailed breakdown of the data.
Chair, I'm asking that they squeeze out the fluff. That is to say, be realistic with the data, take into account the free public area, and this is lower electricity charges because it's regenerable electricity, etc.
Well, yes, Mr. Chair, yes, yes, we should be more detailed. I agree that we should be more detailed in our projections. We will come back with that.
Mr. Chair Wei Chen?
Mr. Chair, I am in principle in support of this.
But I am concerned about the construction cost. 3.6 million Hong Kong dollars per flat, even though this is not a building with a lot of facilities and it is definitely not luxurious. This is high in terms of costs and the management fee as well. And I do not know what's included in the 5.3 recurrent expenditure of the project, but apart from this, apart from the construction cost and the recurrent expenditure, I would like to know more about the project. For example, the car parking space. This is something that's fundamental. You also have a motorcycle parking space, I note. Is it because of design infeasibility, or is it because this is a standard urban planning requirement? I am referring to the visitors and disabled and motorcycle car park space. Why this design? Secondly, in the paper, it mentions about the height. There is a height limit release, of course, with such precious, valuable land, and there is a shortfall of quarters units. My question is this maximum use? This is on the Hong Kong Island. Usually it would be 6 times plot ratio. You mentioned that the site is small, but for a lot of private developments, this site being over 700 square meters, it's not all that small, I would say. There are smaller sites. The urban renewal had come up with even smaller sites in the last round. And the plot ratio should be around 8, I would think. Why is it 6.8 times? If it's 8 times, there will be more flats built, and people don't have to queue up for so long. Mr. Chair, I'll answer the first question, and then the planning department, Ms. Kern, will answer the plot ratio question. Concerning car parking space, indeed there is none, because the site area is floor area is too small. And also, there are two banyan trees, small leaf banyan trees, which we have to preserve in the site area. And this is in the protective area. For the banyan tree, it is 15 meters across with a trunk of 2.2 meters in diameter, 2.55 meters in diameter. And then we have to build the M&E room, the docking and undocking area, the lobby for the lift lobby, etc. And given that, we are not able to build the ramp for the cars to park, nor can we build a turn plate for the car to facilitate car parking. We've considered that, but we cannot put those in. Your time is up. Mr. Chair, yes, according to the Basic Law Stipulation 103, Article 103, the conditions of service for the civil service should be more or less the same as before 1997. But if we look at the queue, this is unfair for the disciplinary forces because the queue for quarters is some 4 years. I'll not look into the public works data figures because there will be time to discuss those. I'm looking at the paper. It says there are only 2,100 units, but the eligible number 2434. What is this? Is it because on service it seems that it is already satisfied, the need for quarters is already satisfied, but in actual fact they have to wait 4 years? Isn't this contravening the basic law? Please let me know. And apart from the few sites mentioned just now, in the Wong Chuk Hang Training Center, with the development of the MTR and with the development of the Ocean Park, perhaps there can be something done even there to shorten the queue and the waiting time. What are some of the hindrances for you to do that, please? Mr. Chair, for the allocation of quarters, before and after the return of sovereignty, the system had not changed. There is a score system, and the score system had not changed either. and this is for married couples' quarters, and the scoring would be the number of family members, the number of years serving in the forces, the remuneration or salary point, and others. Now, the 2,100 are all married persons, and the waiting time of 4 years, we've done the calculation according to scores. Every year, from past experience, we know how many we can cater for every year and how many are still in the queue. And from past situation, we have calculated to 4 years of waiting time. Excuse me. What about before 1997? Was it as long as 4 years waiting time, Mr. Lee? Mr. Chair, I don't have the figure with me, but I don't think there will be great discrepancy. And perhaps it would be longer now than before 1997, reason being the department's bigger with more staff, meaning that qualified number of persons would have increased, and the land and quarters limitation, the growth had not caught up with staff growth. And therefore, the queuing time may therefore be longer, but it would not be because of other factors having changed that the queue had been lengthened. Now, going back to the 2,434 eligible, are you saying that there are already 2,100 units ready and available? Is that what you mean? Yes, Ms. Ng, correct, Mr. Chair. We can provide 2,100 units, but eligible number of persons, 2,434. Mr. Lam Kwok Hong, Mr. Chair, does it mean that over 300 people will not have quarters? And here you're building, 70 units. You're asking for $200 million to build 70 units. Can you not allocate public housing units to them? What about the rank and file or the... can you provide that? For the police... or the disciplinary forces, within 10 years of their retirement, they can already apply for public housing or to buy homeowners scheme houses or units. Now, as a average Hong Kong citizen, if they qualify for public housing, they can apply for that. A three family member family, let's say a disciplinary force member with a child, a son or a daughter, if he qualifies, he can apply for public housing. Well, Mr. Chair, I'm asking because some of the disciplinary forces' remuneration, they're too high to apply for public housing. And the civil service enjoys higher salaries than the private sector, and that is obvious. Otherwise, you're not able to retain people in the civil service. So there is a problem. That is, their remuneration is higher, too high to apply for public housing. And you have 300 people who cannot be allocated quarters. Perhaps they can, what? Provide a queue for them. You're paying them too high. That's a problem. And they'll never be able to eligible for public housing, theoretically speaking, isn't it so? Because with the increments, let's say for correctional services, well, basically, at joining correctional services, he'll be disqualified because of his pay from public housing. But also with more increments year on year. Now, I do not know, but the thing is, should public housing be offered to the civil service? If you say that this is double benefits, then one cannot do so. When I was in prison, I was talking to them. They were saying that they are fearful because they may not be eligible for public housing.
Sir.
Mr. Lee, well, as I said, an officer living in staff quarters, if his retirement is within 10 years and he is eligible, well, then there is a quota for him to apply. Well, we have this system both before and after 1997. What about a serving officer his income is bound to exceed the limit. All right, of course, when he is a pensioner, the income will be lower. I think the answer has already been given. So there is a chance if his retirement is in 10 years' time. Otherwise, he is not eligible. Mr. Wong Yuk-man, I'm against the construction of staff quarters. Well, you provide staff quarters to officers as a housing benefit or to suit the housing, to meet the housing need and to maintain staff morale. This is the objective of this policy. Well, a peaceful time, that's perfectly okay, but the so-called disciplined services nowadays are of varying quality. Some of them do not serve the community wholeheartedly. Many of them regard that as any other job. So how can you maintain staff morale? And the construction of PRH is progressing very slowly. You use land shortage as an excuse. So why are you using valuable land to build staff quarters? To strike a balance, perhaps you should build the same amount of PRH. We have 280,000 PRH applicants waiting. It said that as at March 2016, CSD had 2,434 rank and file staff eligible for DQ, but only 2,100 DQs were available, with a shortfall rate of 13.7%. Eligible staff have to wait for about 4 years on average to be allocated a DQ unit. The shortfall rate is 13.4%, and how come the average waiting time is 4 years? All right, what is the shortfall rate for PRH, and what is the average waiting time? It used to be 3 years, now is 3.9 years. Using the shortfall rate and the waiting time as a justification, the reason why I want to compare, draw a comparison with PRH, well, because they are human beings as well. What you say here is insulting the PRH applicants. Some may think that I have digressed, but I think there are similarities. They all want to have a rooftop, a roof over their heads, and should civil servants be superior to other people? Paragraph 4 says that there are ancillary facilities, including a multifunction room. Now, whenever I see a multifunction room, I'm scared. I'm worried. Will we have something like the CAD, Civil Aviation Headquarters? Well, they have a karaoke room, a dancing room there. So please be more specific as to what is meant by this multifunction room. And some are worried that the site may be too remote and there aren't sufficient car parking space as well. You're so privileged. Your time is up, Mr. Wong Yuk-man. I think you like to express comments more than to expect the result. Yes, of course, I want to make use of this opportunity to make known my views. Mr. Tony Z asked, why can't the plot ratio be increased? Why can't we have a taller building here? Plan department, please. Under the OZB, the height is already 70 MPD on the site, and the Security Bureau has applied for a minor relaxation as a result. The height has been increased by 17%, so it's really higher than the surrounding buildings. For nearby, only about 7 story buildings are allowed. So when you submit a paper to the PWSC, please explain this point, because the number of units appears to be too small, and the construction costs are rather expensive. All right. I'd like to ask whether members support in principle that this paper be submitted to the PWSC for discussion. Do we all agree? All right. I heard one objection. So So department, please provide the paper sought by members to the PWSC. Okay, next. We have report on the public consultation on the establishment of a reporting system on the physical cross-boundary transportation of large quantities of currency and bearer negotiable instruments. For this item, we have Mr. John Lee, Undersecretary for Security, Ms. Manda Chen, Commissioner for Narcotics, Mr. Kevin Lai, Acting PAS for Security, and Ms. Louise Ho, Assistant Commissioner from the Customs and Excise. Welcome. Paper CB21617/1516(01). Undersecretary, can you please introduce the paper to us? Chairman, to further improve Hong Kong system for combating money laundering and financing by terrorists. We report to this panel in July last year on the framework of the government's proposal to establish a system in Hong Kong on the establishment of a reporting system on the physical cross-boundary transportation of large quantities of currency and bearer negotiable instruments. In July and October last year, subsequent to the meeting of the panel, we conducted a three-month consultation exercise. I would like to report to you the outcome of our consultation and the way forward. In general, members of the public expressed support for the R32 system proposed by the task force, by Financial Action Task Force. They believe that this will help to control terrorist activities and cross-boundary crime. Some are concerned as to whether this will undermine our competitiveness and trade. We must stress that under this system, we will not have any form of currency control, and we will not curb the lawful flow of capital. We only require that for over 120,000 Hong Kong dollars that are physically transported into Hong Kong or non-negotiable bearer documents, declaration be made upon entry to the customs and excise, regardless of the amount carried by passengers, they will not be subject to any control, and we believe this system will not pose any obstacles to large volume transactions and trading activities. The US, the UK, Australia, Canada, and a well-developed economy such as Singapore have got a similar system in place. Some of the supporters made suggestions on the operation. For instance, the detailed arrangement for declaration by passengers and for cargo, the designated arrangements, the implementation timetable, and also publicity. All the views have been incorporated into the paper, and we will take them on board as far as possible so that the implementation of the scheme will be easy for the trade and members of the public to follow. We intend to draft the relevant bill for submission to the Council in the next session. Thank you. Members, if you'd like to speak on this R32 system, a show of hands, please. Mr. WONG Yuk-man, Mr. Yu Si-wing, Mr. WONG Yuk-man. 3 minutes, please. In this panel meeting last year in July, towards the end, I asked the Undersecretary a question. Why should the physical cross-boundary transportation of large quantity of currency be controlled by the Narcotics Division? There was no reply back then. But then I've checked the website of the Narcotics Division, and it's found that and a lot of efforts have been devoted to the cracking down of drug trafficking. And then there is this sentence: from time to time they will be involved in the work to crack down on cross-boundary crime and terrorism. Why How is the narcotics division related to money laundering crimes? Is it that they have consider the process of a drug trafficker, but that should be for other law enforcement agencies? What does the narcotics division do to do with the terrorist and money laundering syndicates? Mr. Lee, we want to crack down on finance activities of terrorism and money laundering activities were followed international practice. The FSNTB and also the Security Bureau have different roles. For the former, they would target a financial institution's role in helping money laundering and financing of terrorist activities. And for money laundering of drug traffickers, well, we have two pieces of legislation to tackle that. For drugs, proceeds of drug trafficking is dealt with by the drug trafficking legislation, and proceeds from other crimes is being dealt with by the Organized and Serious Crime Ordinance. The narcotics division has always tackled drug trafficking, and therefore, in terms of division of labor, we believe money laundering and financing for terrorist activities related to crimes should be dealt with by the narcotics division. You just cracked down on drug traffickers and not the terrorists or the financing activities of terrorists. Is the narcotics division capable of tackling these problems? Of course, we will have no objection to the establishment of R32 system. Whether the objective can be achieved is, however, open to question. In paragraph 2, it is said that the policy is to ensure that terrorists and other criminals cannot finance their activities or launder their crime proceeds through such means. But we only talk about $120,000. The ceiling is $120,000. How much can be achieved? What can be achieved with such a small amount of money? How can you ensure that terrorists and other criminals cannot finance their activities or launder their crime proceeds through such means, unless they are asking thousands of people to carry $120,000 each for them? So I don't think you can achieve the objective. I think Mr. Wong has got it wrong. This is really the threshold, not the ceiling. So anyone carrying more than $120,000, then you can raise the ceiling. Your time's up. Originally I set 3 minutes, but I gave Mr. Wong Yuk-man 3 minutes. All right, just a minor issue. What is the penalty? This is a fixed penalty offense. So what will be the fine? $100,000 or $1 million? Well, let me finish. Originally, I said 3 minutes because there were not too many members in the queue. I gave Mr. Wong 4 minutes. So the same applies to Mr. Lam Tai Fai, Mr. Yu Shiwing. Any more? Show of hands, please. I got to control time. All right, I draw a line here. If there are more members waiting to speak, I will substantially cut the speaking time. Mr. Yu Shiwing. As we all know, Hong Kong ranked number one in terms of global competitiveness. I don't know whether the administration has assessed the impact on our competitiveness as a result of the system.
Would that impact us as the most competitive place in the world? Is this one of the factors? And that is, the flow of capital is relatively free in Hong Kong. That's my first question. Second question, for the longest time, for cash flowing in and out of the territory, there had not been a lot of controls. And now with this control coming in, I think there will have to be a time for people to get used to. For example, tourists coming into Hong Kong who do not know about it may
have brought, maybe bringing in more cash than is possible or allowed. Will you allow time for the tourists to know and understand that there is this new control, rather than to slap on a penalty? Would there be a grace time? And if there is a grace time, during which there will only be verbal warning to the tourists and not a penalty slapped, how long will this grace time be? Now, in the mainland, there are different provinces and cities, and when the tourists come in from these provinces and cities, how are you going to disseminate this new development to them so that they know not to bring in too much cash into the territory? Now, first of all, concerning the grace period, there had been a lot of opinions raised proposing that. In drafting the paper, we will be seeking advice from from legal advice, from the DOJ. And for the handling of the grace period, there are a number of ways of doing this. First of all, in our publicity work, we will face that work. In the initial phase, it will be purely publicity. And the next phase would be a period where no penalties will be meted out, but perhaps there may be verbal warning, etc. So there will be relevant operations flexibility so that we can take into account everybody's interests. As for the system, I would want to emphasize this is about declaration and disclosure. We are not limiting people from bringing cash or whatever amount of cash into Hong Kong. It does not affect at all anybody in bringing, what, 1 million, 2 million of cash in and out of Hong Kong. We only want that person to declare and disclose it, that's all. So concerning the question about competitiveness of Hong Kong, in Lausanne, the report coming out for the 10 most competitive areas around the world, 9 of the 10 already have the system. So this should not adversely affect competitiveness. The only one which does not have the system but is within the leading 10 most competitive places around the world is us, Hong Kong. So overseas experience has already told us that the system will not affect our competitiveness, being only a disclosure declaration one. Now, Forex is still not controlled. Capital flow is not controlled. Commodities payments not controlled. This is approved by the UN, in particular the World Bank, the International Monetary Fund, and they all recognize that these measures and systems should be in place and there will be no big impact. Chair Wai-chun, Mr. Chair, I remember not too long ago there was a report saying that for 80% or over of American families, they cannot come up with $7,000 even in an emergency situation, meaning that their culture and behavior are different from ours. Chinese people, especially if I understand mainlanders, they like to transact with cash, including Mr. Chin Pui Chong, my friend back there. At any one time, he will have hundreds of thousands of dollars of cash on him. So combating laundering of money, of course, I'm all for it. But should we not also consider cultural differences? I mean, if we legislate as proposed, and if we, let's say, if you come up with a regulation to make it mandatory for people to save up for old age, the Americans will be up in arms, but not for the Chinese. You don't even have to tell them that, then they will do so. What I'm saying is that people and places are different. I have a question to ask concerning this requirement. It is not applicable to casino chips. I mean, that can be a loophole. We all know the casino is a hotbed for laundering money. Now, if you do not combat this, if you do not pinpoint this. This will be just a show, because this will be a policy which will not be effective, and it disturbs and inconveniences the people, but without being really effective if you do not focus on the hotbed of money laundering. Now, concerning the ceiling, a couple of points. Consider cultural and behavior differences. Should we not make this the cap? That is $15,000. Let that not be the cap. Mr. Chair, first of all, any tourists do not have to change their behavior or habits. If they want to bring in cash, they can do so, whatever amount. All they have to do is to declare. And also the opinions mentioned rights are right in the sense that we need to educate the people. Let's say I bring in $10 million every day, every time coming to Hong Kong. That's fine. Continue doing so. Just declare. Mr. Chair, I think if you have to declare every time you wear a watch, a wristwatch, people will stop wearing wristwatches. This is just an example because it adds inconvenience and risks. I don't think so, Mr. Chair, because the US, the UK, and many countries all have this requirement and system. It's only us. And among the Asian countries, including Indonesia, Malaysia, Vietnam, they all have it. Even our system cannot catch up with theirs? And you're saying that less people will come to Hong Kong because of the introduction of the system which everybody has? I mean, that may be the feeling, but I'm telling you, actual experience overseas is not so. Now, as for the $15,000, can we lift that a bit? As I've mentioned, this is a proposal made by the Financial Action Task Force. All the countries which have this in place do not have anything less stringent. They only have something more stringent. If we have something less stringent, we may be construed as not living up to the standard. We don't want to do something that is neither here nor there. I mean, for the Americans, for some of the other people, of course it's applicable because they don't carry cash. They don't even have savings. Not so for Chinese people. Mr. Chair, for the criminals in money laundering, they have all sorts of ways and very advanced ways of doing this. So I am all for this declaration, this new system to combat money laundering. But we need a few things. First of all, that it has to have deterring effect. And secondly, it must not unduly inconvenience the people. All the opinions raised just now was concerned about possibly inconveniencing the people and competitiveness. I have a question to ask concerning everyday life of the people. You just mentioned that chips, casino chips, not included. Under one country, two system, Hong Kong will continue to have gambling, including horse racing. Now, I'm looking at my wallet. I also have a cash coupon issued by the Jockey Club. I mean, of course, it is not more than $120,000. I don't have that much money. What about this racing coupon? This racing coupon is also freely circulatable. Now, that's the first question. Second question, penalties. What are the penalties? Let's say someone's carrying $120,000 and he's been apprehended or caught. What is the fine? Is it proportional to the amount that he brings in? Is there a sliding scale? What is the deterrent effect? It's like speeding. If you speed for over however many miles or kilometers, there would be a certain penalty, a suitable penalty meted out. What is it like? Mr. Chair, concerning penalties, the first violation, and if the undeclared amount is not huge, then we may have a fixed penalty, and we want it to be summary in approach, and we're thinking the fixed penalty can be 2,000 Hong Kong dollars. We have taken into account overseas penalties levels and also Hong Kong's practice of not declaring taxable cigarettes and liquor. So we're utilizing the existing standards. As for the second violation or more serious violation, we may bring this to the court and the judge will decide. The highest penalty, as the thinking now, is 2 to 3 years imprisonment. And this is commensurate with the UK, Europe, Australia. The imprisonment terms is also 2 years. You mean the second violation would end up in court? That's our thinking. What do you mean you're thinking? Will you be doing this? Mr. Chair, yes, we think this should be done. That would be the penalty. That's what we think is right. Now, the customs had put in a lot of efforts and thinking to see how the new system can be easily acceptable to all. So we're using the existing standards. And what about the Jockey Club cash coupon? Art 32 is about cross-border cash. But for the Jockey Club's cash coupon, it can only be cashable. It can only be encashed in the betting shops in Hong Kong. So it is not going to be brought cross-border. Leung Kwok Hong? So you're saying that this abides by international standards? That's what I heard just now. There's a question. Well, we think that this may hurt the competitiveness of Hong Kong. I think that is unrealistic because there is no disallowing bank transfers. I mean, of course, the banks are regulated by other bodies. I think the end game is that the banks stand to gain because you cannot bring cash out. I want to bring, let's say, $20 million into the mainland. If I want to remit this, of course, there will be a service charge chargeable, isn't it? The banks stand to gain. If I appoint, if I want to pay someone, unless it's underground banks, that's another matter. So I don't know why you're doing this. Actually, in fact, since you cannot bring it with you in person, physically, you have to resort to the bank. In that case, you're making more transactions, generating more banking transactions. I do not know about Macau. I mean, these are international casinos in Macau. I do not know whether the chips can be encashable in the U.S. Macau chips, I don't know. No, they cannot be? All right. So what is the thinking? Yes, bringing it on you, the cash on you, is cumbersome. And if you don't want to declare this, you don't want anybody to know, that is, of course, risky, dangerous. I mean, carrying huge amounts of cash is risky or dangerous. If you go to the toilet and you drop your cash, oh my, that's dangerous. Well, I think your proposal actually benefits the licensed institutions or persons who can transmit the cash. I think that's the upshot of it. Mr. Lee? Thank you, Mr. Chair. I want to emphasize and re-emphasize whatever means you use to bring cash to the place you want to overseas, whether it's through cash or bringing it on you in cash form. With this new law, you can still do so. Mr. Leung, of course, I would not advise you to bring on you $20 million US dollars in cash out of Hong Kong, but if you can use the banking system, or you can do so carrying it yourself.
So under the system, so long as you've made declaration if we have reasons to believe that you are money laundering, then we can take action. So we won't require you to change your behavior. You may force people to change into more casino tokens. What tokens? Well, because casino tokens are exempted. It's just like the transportation of gold. But anyway, I won't argue with you. I know what you're talking about. Well, if I carry a golden bell, then what will you do? But anyway, I won't argue with you because we cannot insult another person's intelligence. Well, we have to understand that there's a lot of room. Now, will we eliminate all forms of money and laundering using this system? Of course not. But of course, I will not say here what are loopholes that criminals can manipulate. We believe there is room for money laundering, and we'll continue to study these possibilities and think how to tackle them. Now, taking money out is not controlled. But what about bringing money in? As far as we understand, I think the ceiling is about 20,000 RMB and $5,000 when it comes to bring money out of the mainland. But in Hong Kong, we only require a declaration and reporting. We will not conduct any investigation. Nor will there be this wrong message, because there is no limit on the amount of money you can carry it out of Hong Kong. But I think there is some control when it comes to bringing money into, bring cash into the mainland. Yes, our mainland laws would not be changed as a result of ours. And we're not asking a person to change his behavior. His behavior may already be against the law or maybe not. All right? As I said, I'm going to substantially cut the amount of time each member can have. Well, Mr. Chen Qiqing, 2 minutes, please. Can you please explain to us the different treatment for coming in and going out? Now, for coming in, there is the red and green channel system, and you can take the initiative to walk through the red channel system. But what about outbound, outgoing passengers? I'd like to know what are the different considerations for outgoing and incoming passengers. Well, can people take the initiative to declare to you when they leave Hong Kong? Well, we have taken reference of our current immigration procedures. We don't want to cause trouble to passengers, and we've also made reference to overseas practice. For there is only one country that has that has the system of disclosure. For the remaining 30-odd systems, they have a similar system as Hong Kong: incoming declaration, outgoing disclosure. Well, when people come in, there is the red and green channel system. People are used to it already. For outgoing passengers, a passenger is only required to disclose the amount of CBNIs he's carrying upon the request of CNED. If he's not stopped by the CNED, then he can go through freely. I think people in Hong Kong are used to this system. They may be checked at the immigration by CNED, and if he's asked how much CBN1 NI he has, he's at 30,000, there is no need to to disclose, but it's over 120,000, the disclosure has to be made, and the customs will seek some information. So it's just a disclosure. So long as the passenger is honest, that's fine. But what if he lies? Of course, if he lies, that's against the law, against this proposed legislation, and maybe other pieces of legislation. So what is required in the disclosure? His name, address, purpose, and his destination, and that's it. Members will have an opportunity to vet the details required in a disclosure in the future bill. I think we have to end the discussion here. Thank you very much, officials, for attending this part of our meeting. And that is on the establishment of the R32 system. There was already a discussion on this previously. I understand that they're going to submit a bill to the council in the next term, okay? The fourth item. Hearing of the Hong Kong Special Ministry Region's third report under the Convention Against Torture and Other Cruel, Inhuman or Degrading Treatment or Punishment. Let us invite the relevant officials in, and also please invite deputations and individuals we have attended to this meeting in. We decided last time to invite relevant deputations to come to express their views while we meet with the administration. Usually, we invite larger deputations with representativeness to come. However, this time, the response is more enthusiastic than anticipated. So there are over 50 deputations or individuals for this session. So we have only until 5:30. So we will follow our because of the time constraints, we can only invite 30 deputations who were among the first to express their interest to come, and for the remaining 20, we have an extra meeting on Saturday to listen to their views. So we have made this arrangement, and we've already informed the relevant deputations. Okay. For this session, we have quite a big team. Mr. TK Lai, Secretary for Security. Mr. Joshua Law, Permanent Secretary for Security. Mr. Billy Wu, PAS for Security. Mr. DC Zhang, PAS for Constitution and Mainland Affairs. Mr. Godfrey Kan, Senior Assistant Solicitor General from Department of Justice. Mr. CF Chow, Chief Superintendent of Hong Kong Police Force. Mr. PH Fung, Assistant Director of Immigration. Mr. YM Wu, Assistant Commissioner of CSD, Ms. Queenie Wong, Assistant Commissioner from the Labor Department, and Mr. MC Fung, Assistant Director from from SWD. Mr. Leung, this is not really a point of order. Please don't confuse deputations here. All right, please stop speaking. All right. I'd like to let deputations or individuals understand that you will each have up to 3 minutes to speak, and your remarks will not be protected by the Legal Powers and Privileges Ordinance, Cap 386. In front of you, we have an earpiece and also a microphone. For the earpiece, please turn into channel 0 for the floor, channel 1 for Cantonese, and channel 2 for English. Channel 3, Putonghua. So you can tune into the channel you prefer, and you will each have up to 3 minutes to speak. The secretary will help me to read out the next to speak, the name of the next to speak. And when your 3 minutes up, there will be a bell to inform you. All right, we'll start now.
Subject word, please.
Okay. Signifying.
Yes.
Yes, please start.
Please speak. You may be seated.
I don't have any presentation.
You speak English?
Yes. But I don't have any presentation.
Oh, you don't have presentation?
No.
Okay.
All right, then next, Mr. Wong Yin Chang. Can I start now? Yes, please. The concern against receiving of bribes. Well, the refugees are involved in all sorts of crimes, robbery, theft, indecent assault, and even murder. A few Hong Kongers were killed recently. I think we've seen this coming, this problem coming, and the government is spending over $1.7 billion on these claimants, and 11,000 of them are waiting for the judicial proceedings, and the trend is rising. This is a cancer for society. If we do not excise it, it will have a lot of negative impacts. Now, there are Pakistanese and Vietnamese who are illegal immigrants. These countries do not have wars, and the political situation is relatively stable. They are only abusing our legal loopholes. They have incessant appeals and judicial reviews so as to buy time so that they can continue to stay in Hong Kong and engage in illegal labor to make a quick cash. And then the smuggling syndicates are also helping them. I have reasons to believe that most of them are economic refugees. They do not fulfill the requirements for non-filement claims. So our concern group strongly condemn these bogus refugees. They commit crimes, they engage in legal employment in Hong Kong. We urge the administration to review the legislation, read this convention ASAP, and if there is sufficient evidence, bogus refugees should be expatriated at once. And then we should also punish employers who employed them very severely. It all boils down to this: prevention is better than cure. If we give people this false hope, then bogus refugees will flood to Hong Kong.
This is a bottomless pit compared to the right of abode for foreign domestic helpers. The impact would be even bigger than that. So I would want to see the different sectors of Hong Kong focus on the seriousness of the so-called refugees issue.
Ms. Choi Ka-wing.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. The Hong Kong branch of Amnesty International, there had been a report given out, but 1 month after, the CE said in its policy address that because of a large number of refugees staying in Hong Kong, he would want to retract from membership of the Convention for Torture, CAT. But this is meaningless because the responsibility of Hong Kong is based on the basic law and also the Convention on Human Rights. So by exiting from the Convention for against torture, basically it would only hurt our public image internationally and also hurt the monitoring role of the relevant bodies in the affairs of Hong Kong. And we urge that the chief executive clarifies his speech and also abide by the International Convention on Human Rights and also follow up on the UN report and to explain his position. And at the same time, for all arrested persons in Hong Kong should be given legal rights, and there should be by the end of the year a report to be made by the Hong Kong government to the UN. The police force is not sensitive enough in handling the arrested. In Mei Lam Chun last year, the police had wrongfully arrested a mentally handicapped young person. And without the presence of his family members, the police had taken statements from him without following guidelines, which was to provide for suitable adults to be on site. And afterwards, there were a revisiting and review of the guidelines for investigation and taking statements. We would want the police to openly make the report public concerning the statement taking, arrests, investigation, especially where it pertains to mentally handicapped persons. What measures will be taken to ascertain access to lawyer and also suitable presence of adults? And we will be following up with the relevant bodies as well as the EOC and the Ombudsman. And further, we urge all sectors and the government to put into execution the guidelines from the UN concerning the use of force and in other areas. Mr. Poon Singh. I am 70 years old. I was born and bred in Hong Kong. I'm very fortunate to have this opportunity to come and speak here. Hong Kong is a place that is crowded with 7 million people. We don't even have a roof over our heads. Why are there these politicians and political parties coming up with all sorts of service for with JR and all that to protect the Southeast Asians who are staying in Hong Kong? They are protecting them. These are vested interests so that the refugees are rushing to Hong Kong. And the numbers of such refugees staying in Hong Kong are on the increase, not on the decrease, resulting in crimes, resulting in dangers to the citizens of Hong Kong. The citizens of Hong Kong are aggrieved. Hong Kong will definitely become a refugee port. Today, I would want to ask the security branch and also the immigration department, the relevant officials, to deploy more staff to combat false refugees, to repatriate them back to their homelands, and not to use public money, precious money, public money, onto refugees. And also exit from the UN Refugees Convention, the Human Rights Convention of 1991, is not all powerful. Recalling the period of 1975, the refugee camps, there were murders in the camps, fires set, riots, and the then British Hong Kong government and the people of Hong Kong suffered. I can still recall those scenes. And in 1998, January 9th, the cancellation of this refugee port of call status for Hong Kong. Why are we re-enlivening that now? The UN HCR, with its 1.1 billion repatriation to the Hong Kong Treasury. I want that to happen, and I do not want any further public money to be spent on refugees. Chan Lai-fan, some people say that this is a nightmare to describe the Vietnamese refugees incidents. The nightmare means that it was not intended, and it's scary. Today's refugees issues, I would say that this is an explosives, homemade explosives, meaning that someone had purposely placed these explosives. Who these people are, we all know. According to the UN, the principle is that all human beings have the same rights and inalienable rights. And this is a basis of human rights. In the 1980s, 1990s, Hong Kong signatories was one of the UN convention, but it became a first port of call for refugees. And over 20 years of Vietnamese stayed in Hong Kong. And after the 20 years, some 60,000 refugees from Vietnam still stayed in Hong Kong. And within the refugee camps, we had to feed them 3 meals a day, provide entertainment, school, and governance, and also management. Think of the resources put into that. And the UN had proffered that there should be fairness, justice, and according to the CAT, the Convention Against Torture signatory, when have they given Hong Kong its own its fairness that it deserves? The epidemics, the rapes, the crimes that were committed, who is to give Hong Kong fairness and justice? Then the UN still owes Hong Kong over $1 billion. There are still payables which are not settled. I first of all urge that the UN, first of all, repays the debt and also really put into place justice and peace, and asking the signatory countries to accept these refugees that are accumulated in Hong Kong. And for the non-Chinese persons committing crimes in Hong Kong, with a crime rate in that area on the rise, we must start again the enclosed refugee camps. I propose that we rent nearby mainland sites. There are two purposes for this. Do not think that the refugees coming to Hong Kong will have 3 meals a day, etc. Your time is up. Next, Mr. Chang Kwong Fung. Chairman, greetings. I am Chang Kwong Fung. I am an ordinary citizen of Hong Kong. Even though a lot of people say that we have to uphold human rights and justice, they all sound very good. But do not forget that Hong Kong is a very small city, so small you cannot see it on the world map. For those who brandish human rights, those countries, compared to them in terms of economic size, in terms of geographical size and area, Hong Kong is but a 2 to 3 year old child compared to them as adults. For a 2 to 3 year old child to bear that burden, what should an adult bear? To ride on the moral high horse and talk about human rights sound all very good, but do we, Hong Kong, have the self-knowledge? Can we bear that burden if we do not have the capabilities but still want to bear that burden? We may be overloaded.
Mr.
Chair, I'm an ordinary Hong Kong citizen. I have a couple of points to say. For illegal immigrants and non-Chinese immigrants, every month there will be 300 of them coming into the territory of Hong Kong. These are false refugees, and they abuse the CAT to stay in Hong Kong. And the crimes that they commit concerning illegal working, robbery, theft, causing the crime rates to rise a few folds. I would want Hong Kong to apply to the central government to exit from the signatory status of CAT and also set up enclosed refugee camps and to deter more refugees from coming to Hong Kong. Yes, Civil Rights Monitor had produced a pink newsletter which had been forwarded to members, and there is a conclusion drawn there. And the government will have to go back to the UN tribunal for the report. Now, the UN committee had expressed concern concerning the CAPO, that it is still a monitoring and consultative body. It does not have teeth. I believe that members should continue to pursue with the government to give practical powers to CAPO and also to mete out penalties and discipline actions where the cases are substantiated. And also the UN Committee Against Torture also had noted that where the there is abuse of power against the arrested. The arrested, because of fear of retribution, refrain from lodging complaints, and this must be looked into. In particular, there has to be more stringent monitoring for the detention centers, for police stations, and where statements are taken. There should be videotaping of the entire process. And also in the police vehicles, there should also be recording facilities. I see that a lot of cases where in the police car, the arrested was abused by the police, but there was no taping or recording and therefore no proof or evidence for taking it further. Now, concerning the guidelines for force using of the police, I do not see any proactive response from the government or relevant departments. I would want there to be a response from the government. After all, this is not confidential information. It should be made public concerning the guidelines of force using. Now, the JP, Justice of the Peace, is a very important role in visiting and monitoring any possible abuse in prisons and detention centers. But in the past, in large-scale arrests, we heard that the JPs were not able to get into the police stations to visit and to look at the or visit the arrested and to look at the facilities. I think the police should follow the guidelines to ensure that the JP's rights or powers are honored. Ms. Fong Kwok San.
Thank you, Chair. Concerning the CAPO, its strength and transparency, that should be enhanced so that where we have mass arrests and refugees, there should be better protection. I've always been against false refugees in snatching away the benefits or undermining the benefits and welfare of the Hong Kong people. I'm also for such centers or detention or camps for them. Yes, there had been more of such so-called refugees, and they are controlled by certain groups, causing the public expenditure to rise in 2015 to 2016, and rising to 1.7 billion next year from 644 million. The year before, and I see that this expenditure is higher than even the expenditure for the old age in Hong Kong. And for the review, it seems that we are reviewing and checking ourselves very strongly. And for the refugees to get that ID or certification in the form of a piece of paper for them to be able to go into the city, I think that is problematic. In the Chang Kwan O and industrial estate, the Long Ha Wan, etc., there are these false refugees who have been coming onto land. They have been hailing taxis and going into the urban areas, and they have been facilitated by criminal organized groups. And the Dai Ah Chow, that is the former Vietnamese refugee camp, can be reopened, and there should be interception of these refugee boats.
And we should target those smuggling syndicates. It was reported earlier that the lynchpins were only sentenced to 2 months of imprisonment on probation or on suspended sentence, and I think that is not good enough. We must do something against those false refugees. Next, Ms. Yip. Thank you. Last September, the convention gave some comments to assist the government to comply with the convention. It's been half a year since the report was published. The administration should give us a clear account of responses and progress of implementation of those recommendations. The government promised to give a report quite soon. Only 6 months are left, so that the government should tell us the progress. And if the government gives us this paper, which we regarded as being inadequate, then this is not right. All right. We want an independent investigation of the urban the umbrella movement. The government connived at the police to use excessive force and abuse its power against protestants. With an independent investigation panel involving international human rights experts should be set up as soon as possible, and the findings should be published to be fair to all people affected, and all people who abuse power should be taken to task, including the policemen. Second, safeguards against the police. There was a reference to the case at Mae Lam Estate. The rights of an arrested person were not arrested, were not protected. This could affect everyone in Hong Kong, but we can all be arrested all of a sudden. And once arrested, our rights are not protected at all, and this is unacceptable. In the concluding remarks of the UN committee, it is suggested the police publish its internal guidelines to ensure that they align with international standards as a first step. And secondly, subsequent to the Mae Lam Estate case, the police promised to review its guideline or code of practice for handling such cases. We'd like to know the progress of the review, and there must be legislative safeguards. We cannot really just rely on internal guidelines so that victims can seek compensation under the law. And all police officers that have breached the regulations must be taken to task. And the intention to be part of the convention is not to give to allow the administration to follow the requirements as it please, like what Lang Chanying is doing. Now, in coming up with more expeditious procedures, well, I'm afraid your time is up. Mr. Chen Chi-ho, as a member of the international community, Hong Kong that has the duty to do a part. However, you must look at your own affordability when you want to assist people. Otherwise, you are being kind to refugees but cruel to your own people. You cannot pawn your own pants in order to help other people. This is very basic. The problem of forced refugees has caused a lot of negative impacts to our law and order and use of public resources. Hong Kong is spending hundreds of millions of dollars on forced refugees, and they're causing more and more law and order problems. They have posed nuisance to our community life. There is evidence that forced refugees is now an industry, is a channel for making money. All responsible officials and legislators have the duty to help to address this problem. First, at places where a lot of forced refugees live, there should be stop a police patrol and police presence so that they will not negatively affect our law and order. Secondly, there should be enhanced cooperation with the main authorities to intercept refugees before they arrive here so that they cannot seek non-refoulement claims as soon as they arrive here. And secondly, we should set up a closed camp so that all refugees can be put inside the closed camp. They shouldn't be allowed to run wild in our community, posing problems to our daily lives. And thirdly, we should seriously consider whether we should withdraw from the CAT. And if there is evidence, and if a person, there is evidence a certain person has turned this into an industry, into a tool for making money, then we should step up the penalty to plug the loophole. Thank you. Mr. Lee Ka-leung. Thank you, Chairman and members of the panel. Good afternoon. The problem of forced refugees have plagued Hong Kong. This is a loophole so that people who have ulterior motive can come to Hong Kong to become illegal workers or engage in crimes. And therefore, I'm of the view that we should set up a closed camp and before screening. We can only reduce the incentive for them to come to Hong Kong if they're not allowed to work. And then we can then ensure that the real claimants would not be affected. Some said that the rights of detainees should be protected. But what about the rights of frontline public officers? Shouldn't we protect them as well? Immigration Department is responsible for maintaining or managing the detention center, and they are overloaded and they are not prepared to deal with possible riots in the center. They need training from CSD, which is not able to give them training because the workload is also very heavy. Since we have we are a member of CAT, we must do something. I'm a member of the Sai Kung District Council. Sai Kung used to be a very harmonious community where we have all sorts of nationalities living together, but because of the forced refugees, bias or prejudice has grown against ethnic minorities. Now, if we do not take appropriate measures, then ethnic minorities are actually born in Hong Kong, may be subject to discrimination. So we must set up a closed cam in order to tackle this problem. Next, Mr. Lai Chi-sheng.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Regarding CAT, DAB is of the view that after we become party of CAT, well, in the community, we've heard that there are criminals arranging for people to enter Hong Kong illegally, and there are loopholes in our legislation, and of course, there is the problem of fake refugees. At this point, we should see how we can implement these recommendations and improve our system. We have loopholes, and these problems have caused us failure to comply with CAT effectively, and this is also about deployment of resources. In the first quarter of this year, we have 11,000 cases pending screening. Last year, we spent $700 million. We expect that in 2017, we're going to spend more than $1 billion on this. According to the police, these claimants had a crime engaged in 632 crimes cases in 2011, and in 2015 it rose to 1,152. So the analysis is very clear. There is clearly abuse of this system. Many of the claimants are not genuinely refugees suffering persecution. Rather, they're here to make a living. So we should use various ways and means to ensure that we can really honor our obligations under CAT and to help the genuine claimants. We must block the existing loopholes ASAP before we can screen real refugees effectively. DAP has six suggestions. First, we should set up a closed camp for refugees. Secondly, the government should continue to cooperate effectively with mainland authorities to intercept these IRs at source. Three, we should also amend the standard uniform mechanism for screening to avoid abuse. Within a certain period of time, upon arrival, claims must be lodged, and claimants must submit all the evidence by a certain deadline. And four, we should review our immigration ordinance. We should streamline the screening procedure so as to expedite matters. Fifth, we should lower the cap for assistance to these people. And five, six, we must expedite repatriation. Now, we must do this in order to honor our obligations under CAT.
Thank you. Good afternoon. I'm from Taipo. There are refugees, and we've also got Southeast Asians. Starting from the 24th to the 30th of May in Taipo, there were two cases of Southeast Asians robbing elderly persons on the streets. Now, for a genuine refugee, as a matter of on humanitarian grounds, we should help them. But these are not real refugees. They are fake. They've come from their countries where they apply to go to Shenzhen or Guangzhou to on the pretext they are seeing relatives there, and then they would take a boat at Taya Bay to come to Hong Kong. They would throw the documents into the sea on the way, and they each pay 2,000 to 3,000 RMB for the trip. So everything is organized and syndicated. They know Hong Kong laws quite well. They come here to seek non-refoulement protection so as to delay their stay here. We have reasons to believe that someone from the legal sector, we might have some legislators coaching them. The reason why I say so, well, I'll tell you later. According to media reports, from January to the 2nd of June this year, we have got 230 cases of Southeast Asians committed crimes. 254 have been arrested. On the 15th of April at Castle Peak Bay,
the Immigration Department, there was a riot. And on April 24th, Tongkok, there was a brawl between the so-called refugees and Hong Kong people. And on the April 23rd in Tung Tau Wan, Stanley Correctional Services compound, there were false refugees from South Asia having brawls with the Hong Kong people. As legislative members or as senior officials of Hong Kong government, with these false refugees coming into Hong Kong in an organized and syndicated manner, how much resources can we have to burn for this? Medical, transportation are all issues. Yes, your time is up. Please stop. Ms. Adela Namajembe.
Ladies and gentlemen, I speak on behalf of Refugee Union Hong Kong. At this moment, I'd like to thank the organizers, officials, individuals in your capacity for this precious opportunity given to represent Refugee Union Hong Kong. Refugees deserve protection. Hong Kong promised to protect refugees on 19 December 1992 when the United Nations Convention Against Torture, call it CAT, was extended to Hong Kong. The most important point is protection. During screening of cases, why are 99.5% of the cases rejected? Can Hong Kong honestly say that 99.5% of claims cannot be substantiated? It is possible that USM is unsuitable to substantiate refugees' claims. What is the use of screening mechanism that rejects 99.5% of the cases? Should we say that is biased? Is the USM used as immigration, as a migration control system to reject unwelcome people? If USM was designed to protect refugees, wouldn't the acceptance rate be higher? What would be reasonable international standards? Is it by 10%, 5%, or 1%? In developed countries, the refugees' acceptance rate is between 25% and 45%. How can Hong Kong justify a 0% acceptance rate in 23 years since 1992? Yet it signed the Convention Against Torture. Request. Refugees need respect of personal liberty. Refugees demand stop to smear campaigns. According to
Time is up, Ms. Tang Meijing. The establishment had been asking for the establishment of enclosed camps and to exit from the convention, CAT. This is violence.
the establishment or the establishment party is asking for violence against the refugees. In between 2009 and 2015, it says that there are over 4,000 crimes committed by false refugees. But if you look at the entire crime rate, it is over 510,000 crimes committed all over in Hong Kong. This is especially true for the Oriental Daily. It's using terminology such as South Asian bandits, South Asian robbers to describe these people. And this is not right. This is racial discrimination. Freedom of speech should be respected, but not racial discrimination. And the CE had also spoken ill of the refugees. We have our group had accused the Oriental Daily of fanning racial discrimination. And the next day, the Oriental Daily had said, do not, Ms. Leung Mei Ching, do not go out in the night. If you are kissed by a false refugee, you might even enjoy it. This is personal attack. How can there be such racial discrimination and such speech in the public? In the past few years, the establishment party had had come to realize that CY Leung is a burden on them, and that's why they stir up these refugees. The long queue for housing is because of refugees. What they're doing is pitching the poor against the poor. But in fact, it is these pro-establishment people who are taking all our money away. The reason why we do not have a universal retirement scheme is because these pro-establishment parties are using all the money to build these infrastructure. Regina Yip, Su Wong Fan, and Priscilla Leung, these are the people. These are the people who are selling us out. And now they're saying that they are protecting the interests of the Hong Kong people. A person would be blind to believe them. We are against this so-called combating of false refugeeship. Yes. Exiting from the CAT, etc., all this talk is not about security, it is about politics. The pro-establishment had been at a loss in the past few years. The CY Leung had come up with all sorts of bad policies, and this is an opportunity just before the elections to stir up this refugee issue, stirring up that there are a lot of South Asians and refugee crimes. But in fact, many of the South Asians, we have 66,000 South Asians in Hong Kong, just over 10,000 refugees in Hong Kong. But the point is the conspiracy is to single them out and beat them up with public opinion. And at the time, it was said that with 7 years of living in Hong Kong, there will be permanent residency for the refugees, and that would bring in hordes of refugees. That was the discussion in the 1990s and in 2006. And now it is this same trick again, stirring up public animosity against the refugees, etc. And in fact, the pro-establishment embrace Western values. This is like the Trump in the U.S. It is like the Liberal Party in Austria and the French far-right parties. This is to get political capital by creating this kind of hatred and xenophobia. This is pitching the poor against the poor so that the people refocus on the minorities and refugees so that the pro-establishment can stand to gain. Over Over 99% of the refugees are false refugees, it is claimed. Why is our threshold that high? Some of the refugees had formed their own families in Hong Kong, stayed for over 10 years, maybe even 20 years, having set up their family, and then you tell them to leave because they are not refugees. What are they to do? And even with the CAT membership, in fact, they can only leave. They will have to apply to another country all over again. I mean, talking about the Hong Kong medical services, I mean, that's already been broken as a system. 36 hours waiting in the emergency ward. Is it really because of refugees? Ms. Lee. Yes, after the Second World War, Hong Kong had 500,000 missing persons. Till now, I do not see the Hong Kong government or the UN done anything for these missing persons. Please, the EOC, do something right away. Other people fight their wars. We foot the bill. This is not right, not just. There have to be a selection system for the refugees. We do not want to turn tourists away, but at the same time, we want to invite refugees. We have no livelihood. We have to go for legal aid. At least then I will have some work. Chongqing building with rapes and murders, we do not hear that. Women turn a blind eye to that. Who is to foot that bill? Is it because there are vested interests who are divvying up the spoils? Now, the minimum wage is something that we have to fight for. However, the public money is spent purely by the powers that are without public sanctions. We have to either fly a plane to Syria and bring in their refugees to Hong Kong. We cannot help Snowden. Even Snowden had to leave Hong Kong. For Godba, the ICAC arrested even Godba and back then. And we are fair. We are just. Hong Kong is fine. The refugees spend so much public money, and let me just declare interest. I do not have work while the refugees may find employment. We have rights and therefore we have responsibilities. We have to look into the UN Convention. We have to change our system and policy. Declare of interest here. I have no relationship, no particular interests, and vis-a-vis the refugees. And members here who are paid, who are NGOs, please speak up, please declare yourself. And Hong Kong has no charitable law. If we are to help refugees, if you are an NGO, you should qualify as a charitable organization first. Mr. Kwan Sam Wai? In the 1970s and 80s, the refugees have caused grave social problems and also in crimes as well. And it was a huge burden for Hong Kong. Now it is creating another bottomless pit. There was a man who was killed because of a can of beer, was killed by false refugees, leaving the widow and children behind. I have other true stories to tell. I have a friend who lives in Sham Shui Po, going back home after work. There are a lot of South Asians in Sham Shui Po. I do not know whether there are false refugees in the midst, but he was surrounded by South Asians who robbed him, got his cash, they didn't want visa cards and phones. Why? Because the person, my friend, did not go to the police, and he said, because with Dr. Chang Chiu Hong to protect them, and he will protect these people arrested. You are the destructive party, throwing bricks in Mong Kok. You have lawyers to protect them. False refugees making Hong Kong's security, breaching Hong Kong's security. Dr. Cheung, what have you been doing? You have been looking for welfare for the refugees, and as a result, a lot of refugees are going into the seas and they die coming to Hong Kong. You are murdering them. Now you're saying you're helping Hong Kong people. Who are the Hong Kong? Identify Hong Kong people. Why are you protecting the refugees applying for residence rights in Hong Kong? Are you treating, fleecing the Hong Kong people? You are adding oil to fire. Now, for the Hong Kong people, we may not have the right statistics, it may not be accurate, but I am but a small citizen. All I see that you are objecting every day, you are filibustering every day at the Letcho. How does it help Hong Kong in terms of crime? Those people of you who are helping the refugees, one case is too many. Would you please be responsible in your speech? Hong Kong people work hard to make ends meet. But you people, Cheung Chiu Hong, Professor Cheung Chiu Hong, you are beyond care. You help the so-called refugees. You come and go as you please. How do you answer to that? Ms. Chen Hua Chu.
I am a citizen of Hong Kong. I hope the legislators or those politicians can listen carefully. We have the electoral election in September. Please tell us whether you support these refugees. If you do, then we're not going to give you our vote. Secondly, why should legislators be paid to solicit donations on the 4th of June? Have you ever told us where the money will go to? Why are you seeking donations? Are you doing that for the sake of refugees? Are you going to spend these donations on helping refugees and some so-called organizations? Ms. Peng, please pause for a while. Deputations or individuals, please do not interfere with another person's speech, and please do not speak unless I direct you to do so. Thank you, Ms. Peng. And also ask these so-called legislators, you seek donations on the 6th of June. Now, if you have so much time, why don't you go to some shopo where there are so many refugees? I would like to dare you to walk down the streets there. Now, if you dare not, let me tell you that many members of the public dare not do so. I dare not do so. I used to be able to do that. Well, we used to have closed camps. Why can't we have closed camps now? We have a population of close to 7 million. So, are you filibuster here? Since you love human rights, why don't you resign from your post here in the legislature, in this legislature, and go to UN to help the refugees? And I also like to ask the the lawyer political party, well, do you have any interest involved? You help the refugees in so many cases. Have you created or make up these cases to make money out of it? Hong Kong people also have human rights. What about people waiting for PRH? Where has the money gone? And Claudia Mo, you drag your suitcase around town to drive the tourists away. So why don't you drag your suitcase to drive the refugees away? Lastly, I'd like to ask the children here, do you pay taxes? The umbrella movement is a riot. It's not a revolution. You occupy Central, you occupy Hong Kong. Your time is up. Mr. Tang Tak Singh. Thank you. I come here to speak on our refugee policy because this problem has come to a threshold because it's going to disrupt social harmony. Over 92.5% of the cases are not substantiated. Someone behind me said perhaps the mechanism is too stringent. If that's the case, how come there are still so many refugees rushing to Hong Kong? Why are we so attractive? I think this is a very good question. This is because there are people inside this legislature who are helping these forced refugees, giving them assistance, and that is an economic incentive for forced refugees to come. We would like to condemn openly Fernando Zheng from the Labour Party. He is the cause of the problem. He is providing assistance to forced refugees, eroding our resources. If the speed is too slow, then well, if a refugee is forced, then even if we can complete the procedure in one day, he will still not be accepted. In 2014, housing allowance for these people were raised, and the Fernando Zheng asked for another revision in 2015. This is even faster than the revision of CSSA allowances. Many Hong Kong people are inferior when it comes to public assistance received from the government. Fernando Zheng or the Labour Department demands that these refugees be allowed to work in Hong Kong. I'd like to ask whether the Labour Party wants to serve local workers or do you want to break the rice bowls of local workers? Now, if the floodgate is open, what if we have a flood of mainland refugees rushing into Hong Kong, asking to work here, competing for jobs with our grassroots workers? I'd like to ask whether Fernando Zheng is going to give them the same treatment. All right, you say that the human rights records are so bad in Hong Kong. Why should you assist the refugees to remain in Hong Kong? You are really harming them. You should send them to the U.S. since the U.S. Is such a good place. Am I correct, Mr. Zheng? All right, why are you assisting refugees? Aren't you contradicting yourself? And Mr. Alvin Yeung, you are very close to the localists in Hong Kong. Your time is up. May I remind all deputations and individuals who are present today not to speak without my invitation. If you repeat it again, I will regard it as disrespect for the council and I may invite you to leave. Thank you. Mr. Chen Yuk-long, thank you, Chairman. I'm just an ordinary member of the public. I'm here this afternoon because I cannot tolerate this problem anymore. I live in Kowloon West, one of the disastrous areas when it comes to forced refugees. And at my place of work, every day I see many Southeast Asians. Since we have non-refoundment claims, more and more Southeast Asians are loitering in my community, even very late at night. And the law and order situation has worsened. We heard about snatching, smashing of head, so that we dare not venture out if there are no genuine needs at night. Who should be held accountable for all this?
should legislators be here to help local people? Why should they help the Southeast Asians? We voted for you, hoping that you could help Hong Kong and Hong Kong people. Fernando Zhang from the Labour Party is the biggest culprit. He is consistently helping Southeast Asians to stay in Hong Kong. These are people who are East Asians, South Asians. In fact, these people are not eligible and they stay behind to compete for resources. Our economy is already so bad. And I think Fernando Zhang would not stop until we are really in a very bad situation. In fact, you are paid by taxpayers. You are damaging the interests of Hong Kong, not helping us. I will certainly not vote for you in the September election. Thank you. Madam Kwok Iwa, thank you. The convention says that even if a refugee has committed a criminal offense, he will not be repatriated or be disqualified. In 2006, a refugee was detained and he said that he was not being treated humanitarily, and he sued the Director of Immigration, the Commissioner of Police and the CSD, and he won 210,000 as a result. So he is rich. He is a rich man now. We are burning money for them, thanks to the politicians in Hong Kong who have received bribes or sponsorship from the US and other external forces. They are creating trouble in Hong Kong, disrupting our daily lives, so that our law and order, our lives and property and safety are being threatened. We are taxpayers, but where are our human rights? Do we really have democracy and freedom in Hong Kong? These are outsiders. They have never worked and paid tax in Hong Kong. And yet they are protected by these politicians. They are really blessed in Hong Kong. They are better off than Hong Kong people. They receive even better living allowances. Now for CSSA, a CSSA recipient only received 2,300, and for these people, they can get 3,200 or 3,400 each. The Middle East war caused by the U.S. has started this refugee problem, and yet they can continue to print money, and we lost tens of billions of dollars as a result of the Vietnamese refugee. And then we are just a small Chinese city. We're asked to foot the bill of the war between the British and Argentina. So we are already badly hurt. Why do we have to entertain these false refugees? If they were really subject to torture and prosecution in their home countries, yes, we may be willing to help. But have you been to Sham Shui Po and see how they fight? Hong Kong people fight with fists, but they use iron chains, they use spades, and also a cement badge to fight. The Liberal Party has always advocated helping people who are in need. According to statistics, only 1 out of 200 cases was substantiated. So, is there something wrong with the mechanism? Is the threshold too high?
Well, if they are genuine political refugees and have been subject to political persecution before they arrived, how come we read or we learned from the media that they threw their passports into the sea before they arrived? Why couldn't they come with their documents so that the immigration department can check their identity? Why have they deliberately stalled the investigation process? What is their hidden agenda? I think this is clear from their crime statistics. True, we have about 10,000 or so applications, but for these suspected refugees in Hong Kong, they have really disrupted our law and order. You may say that in total we have hundreds of thousands of crimes, but even one case is one too many when it comes to crimes. Now, if we have one less refugee, then there is one less case of crime. So why don't we face up to this problem seriously? The LP has always asked for them to be kept in a closed camp. And we want the administration to review the system. Can we continue to allow people from other countries to arrive in Hong Kong through different channels, and then they can stay behind forever claiming that they are refugees? Well, just to quote an example, India has a population of 100,000. Can we allow all 100,000 million? Can we all allow them to come here? Well, if it's just 1/10, there's already 10 million. We only have a population of 7 million. Do we have enough resources, enough capacity to accept this? Shouldn't the administration discuss with these authorities or the world to tell them that there is a limit to our tolerance? Mr. Chow Ing Ken, we're here to find a way out in a rational manner. I have been in contact with refugees for decades. Well, some of them hide away in Hong Kong. They are happy so long as they could make a living here. Most of them will be living in rural areas, engaged in the recycling industry. They will want to be in hiding for as long as possible because they're not sure whether they stand a chance, and they would rather not seek any claims. And for the second batch, if they lodge a claim, they would tell you at once whether they've been subject to political or religious persecution. I think we should follow the practice of European countries. For instance, they must come out within 60 days. Well, 20 years ago, I was a CSD officer. I have really worked in a closed camp. Now, perhaps you don't understand how it operates. Their kids have not received any vaccination and no vaccination. It is not really inhuman to keep them in a camp so that they can receive all sorts of services, so that they will not pose any threat to the community by living in different places of town. Most of them live in SDUs and containers of rural and containers where there are no sanitary equipment, and they're subject to a lot of problem, and they don't have friends unless they're accepted by the compatriots. Now, after screening, of course, they can be allowed to live in an open camp like the Vietnamese refugees pending immigration to other places. And for receiving countries, we should sign a memorandum of understanding. These countries should be required to sign that no, they will not suffer any revenge when they are repatriated. However, the expenses should be borne by their source countries. I think these are matters of policy we should consider. And at methadone clinics, I saw refugees trafficking drugs, and I've made a video clip, and it will be published to the media soon. Mr. Wong Wai Shen, thank you.
Yunnan is an area where there are a lot of South Asians. As a district councillor in the area, of course, I'm concerned about this. And a lot of us are concerned about the lack of sufficient police power within the area and presence within the Yunnan area. And as you know, the South Asian population had increased to 67,000, but the police presence had not been growing in step. We have reflected this to the relevant departments, in particular to the police and the security bureau. Please and reinforce the police presence in Yunnan. And a lot of citizens had mentioned there should be more uniform patrol of police on the streets. I know, of course, there are auxiliary police as well, and there are certain servicing or service hours cap. Perhaps I'm asking whether the auxiliary police under certain circumstances can have the maximum hours of service released so that they can help with more patrolling so that there can be a deterrent effect on the crimes of some of the so-called refugees. Now, for some refugees who claim protection under CAT, there are some 9,800 plus cases which are waiting for handling. I think what is urgent is that the government should clear this backlog by putting in more resources so as to segregate the false refugees and have them repatriated. Very much thank you. We have 25 individuals and organizations altogether coming up to the LegCo today to voice your opinions. You are able to speak freely here, but I would also want to urge you to be respectful of each other, even though you have different political persuasions, different viewpoints, but let us please do respect each other in our freedom of speech. Yes, and I will now allow time for members of the LegCo to, based on some of the opinions expressed just now, to raise questions or to ask follow-up questions. Yes, we have government officials here as well. This can be a two-way communication. I have here Priscilla Leung and Dr. Chang Chiu Hong, Fernando Chang Chiu Hong, who would want to speak. Yes. You want the government, the administration to respond? Yes, indeed, Mr. Lai. Well, thank you very much for coming up and having your opinions made known. I can summarize your views into a number of points, and also there are questions asked which we will respond. Quite a number of members or delegates or citizens have talked about the exiting from the convention CAT to strengthen the screening system, set up closed camps, strengthen enforcement, strengthen cooperation with the mainland to intercept illegal refugees, and also improvement on the review system. For example, a delegate had mentioned that all applicants will have to make the applications within 60 days of reaching Hong Kong and provide all the evidence and documentation. So this is these views about the non-repatriation application. Let me reiterate the stance of the Hong Kong SAR. The UN Refugee Convention had never been enforced in Hong Kong. For the Hong Kong laws and also the CAT and also our human rights law that we have locally and also our basic law and also the precedents from our own law courts, a foreigner illegally coming into Hong Kong or legally entering Hong Kong but overstaying, when the Immigration Department repatriates them and they lodge an application for non-repatriation, the Immigration Department will have to follow the standards set by the court with high degree of fairness to handle the application. I want to take this opportunity to mention another point. Some delegates have talked about or raised certain numbers, saying that many of the applications have been thrown out. Does it mean that we have overly high a threshold? I want to be very, very clear in telling everyone here. Our threshold is based on the statutes and the laws and the precedents set by the rulings of the court. And also after the first layer of review, if any applicant feels that he is aggrieved or objects to the conclusion, he can go to an independent appeal board or committee for lodging his appeal. And the appeal committee will look at the case afresh. And after these two steps had been taken, I would firmly believe that the threshold or standard that we apply would not be inappropriate. Further, after the second layer, that is the appeal committee, if the appellant can further go to judicial review if he so wants to. And there have been delegates saying that we should step up with interception of illegal immigrants. I totally agree with that. The Hong Kong, together with the mainland authorities, but public security department in particular of the mainland, we are working together to intercept illegal immigrants. And in terms of penalties and punishment, we are amending the immigration law ordinance for persons assisting illegally persons from outside of Hong Kong, that is foreigners, entering into Hong Kong territory. We have made the punishment or penalty more hefty. That is, if apprehended, whether these are aider, abettors, or drivers of the speedboats, the highest penalty after the court at a higher court, the higher court at maximum can mete out a 14-year imprisonment sentence. Case in point, recently, a few people, because they had been bringing in illegal Vietnamese illegal immigrants into Hong Kong, they had been given a 4-year sentence, and this is already after mitigation. As for police power, some of you had mentioned that there are a number of security and law and order issues. We treat this very seriously. And some delegates had talked about the raised certain questions. You have raised questions about mentally handicapped persons handling by police, JP visits of the arrested, Occupy Central incident, yellow umbrella incident, etc. We will, according to the request of this panel, we will follow the honored mechanism in responding to your queries and comments. I have Fernando Zheng, Priscilla Leung, and Sid Ho, and Xin Chong Kai, and others. We have to end our meeting by 5:30 today. Now, there are five members who want to speak. I will allow 5 minutes. I will not allow any further time. And if you want the other side to respond, please plan your time wisely. You have 5 minutes question and including answer. Yes, please be advised that you may be asked questions. Yes, this is a time for the questions to be asked by the members of the lecture. Priscilla Leung, Chair, thank you. Thank you very much for coming up to the lecture to make your views known. I am for more stringent measures in intercepting false refugees. We're talking about false refugees, not about racial discrimination. Those who are twisting the false refugee issue into race discrimination issue. There are such people. I am a friend of the racial minorities. I have an incident where they have been robbed, and over the many years, they have been under the threat of robberies, and even it's been life-threatening. And they say that they have to leave Hong Kong if we persist with this. Now, this is nothing about racial discrimination. This is about legal residents in Hong Kong and illegal immigrants, on the other hand. We have a lot of information evidencing this. I'm looking at posters, which are ads in their home country. 15,000 agency, $15,000 agency fee, and they will be able to come to Hong Kong with $8,000 Hong Kong per month. And also, there are these quote unquote certificates, ID certificates, with which they can work in Hong Kong. Now, for the legal minorities residents in Hong Kong, where do they stand? Now, if we have a lot of them say, if we put in the closed camps, if we do not provide that kind of financial support, many of the interviewed in these other countries say that they will not come, if that is the case in Hong Kong. Now, Mr. Vijay, if we are to set up these closed refugee camps, cutting down the incentives for these people coming to Hong Kong. There is a hardiosens principle in common law, meaning that we can detain the refugees or potential refugees so as to allow time, let's say a few months, to identify which are the genuine refugees. And during this time, the closed camps would not accumulate a lot of people, a lot of immigrants, illegal or immigrants. Now, for illegal immigrants, I already see that there are people driving their own boats coming to Hong Kong. This is a big loophole. For friends which are legal residents in Hong Kong, racial minorities, they feel threatened. Vijay, Mr. Vijay, will you answer or respond to that?
A life threat out of this problem of the illegal immigrants who claim to be torture victims.
Yes, actually, we are the evidence for these incidents because we suffer already. And I can say that all the attacks which happened before, it's all done by fake refugees. I can say it's fake refugees who is just only taking the advantage of this our system in Hong Kong system. So really, if we can something like make the closed camp or something, then at least the fake people will not come anymore, and it will help really to the Hong Kong to something like the separate the lawful resident and the fake refugees.
Okay.
Yeah. So the idea of detention camp to separate the lawful residents and the unlawful residents, yes, would be one of the alternatives.
Yes, it's
right?
Absolutely perfect.
Okay, thank you. Yes. 局長, 他現在修改的法例根本不合適。
So what if legislative amendments do not work? I think Ms. Leung was talking about a recent case where 25 IIs traveled to Hong Kong in a small vessel. Well, this is a very dangerous act, as a speaker said, they could have lost their lives in the sea. And one of the 25 are not being prosecuted for assisting IIs to enter Hong Kong. Dr. Fernando Zhang. Thank you, Chairman. Many deputations and individuals have spoken this afternoon, and I feel shame for Hong Kong. Hong Kong started with many refugees. My mother arrived in Hong Kong as a refugee to flee the war on the mainland. She fled to Macau and then came to Hong Kong. Two refugees, I think we should give them assistance. When people flee from wars and riots and persecutions because of political and religious grounds, Hong Kong as an international city should give them assistance. We should not give them further persecution, because that could cause us to violate the international convention, the UN convention. The convention seeks to protect Hong Kong people. The protection under CAT we'll see. Well, during the umbrella movement, we saw excessive violence used by the police and also unchecked police violence. And I think that is the biggest problem. I think the number of cases is out of proportion to so-called abuse cases by forced refugees. Perhaps it's close to the elections. Some speakers said that many years ago, some political parties or candidates helped foreign domestic helpers to come to Hong Kong to get the right of abode. However, the issue died down as soon as the elections were over. I anticipate that after the elections in September, the debate over this issue would also die down. I think we cannot adopt such a selfish attitude. We should not really trample on the most vulnerable in society in order for our own benefits. This really cannot, this is not in keeping with the spirit of Hong Kong. Some speakers said that these are refugees, commit rapes, murders, robberies on a daily basis, and they say that they are South Asians, and South Asians are criminals. This kind of smearing is very unfair to South Asians, and it's also an insult to people who have come to Hong Kong to seek protection. I think this is very unfortunate. I hope that the administration can face up to this situation. The representative from refugees pointed out that success rate in Hong Kong was the lowest in the world. This is really regrettable, and the mechanism is established after this requirement by the court. So refugees are asking, how come our mechanism would only allow 0.5% cases to be successful. So is this mechanism effective or not? Lastly, I'd like to return to the question of police powers. If there are no checks and balances, if our IPCC does not enjoy any independent investigatory power, then we cannot really monitor police powers. In Malam Estate, a mentally retarded person was wrongly arrested, and after that, the police promised to review the guidelines, but the police don't have to be accountable to us. The convention requires the police to publish how what the guidelines is about when it comes to the use of violence by the police, but we haven't heard anything from the administration yet. All right, Dr. Zhang has talked a lot. I've only got 10 seconds for illegal occupation of central. I really agree with the police. We have acted in accordance with the laws. You have seen how DOJ tackled the issues. Whoever has broken the law will be taken to task. I remind members to leave time for the administration to respond. Dr. Elizabeth Quart, thank you, deputations, for coming this afternoon. For non-refoulement claimants, I think the statistics, the facts speak louder than anything, because there are facts, there is evidence that there is abuse. Even when I exposed this problem, I said that for genuine refugees who have come from countries at war, well, if they're here to seek a refuge, then as a member of the international community, we should, it is right for us to give them our help. However, there are loopholes in the system, and syndicates and also people who have ulterior motive are abusing this loophole. We cannot deny the fact that there are abusers because we have different political opinions. We cannot turn a blind eye to the fact that these false refugees that are abusing our system are creating law and order problems. They are really affecting our community. I've received complaints from all sides. Different communities face threats in law and order. The DAB has got a working group on ethnic minorities, and we have complaints from local ethnic minorities who have lived in Hong Kong for generations. They are law-abiding residents, but when they do business, they face problems. There's a case when a person's jewelry was robbed on the street. So do we think we can resolve the problem by just being kind? Dr. Fernando Zhang, I understand your concern for refugees. I also agree that we need to protect the genuine refugees, but I hope you understand that there are false refugees abusing our resources, causing a bottleneck. As a result, we cannot help the genuine refugees, and this is our real concern. So please do not attacked one another simply because we have different political opinions. We want to resolve this problem. We want to help ethnic minorities, local ethnic minorities, and we want to give everyone in Hong Kong safe environment to live, and we should not cause unnecessary pressure to pressure to bear on our law enforcement agencies. Our police officers, our immigration officers face a lot of pressure, and they are working very hard. Our LEAs are facing this problem on a daily basis, and these problems have to be addressed. We cannot be too kind. We cannot, because we are kind, we turn a blind eye to the real situation. So we must pluck
our loopholes in order to get rid of forced refugees. The DAB and myself have been giving lots of suggestions to the administration to resolve the problem. It's not that the government has done nothing about it. It has tried to crack down on the leaders of smuggling syndicates. But then, I urge the administration to provide more resources and manpower to the police so that they have the resources to tackle the problem, and give more resources to the immigration department so that they can manage the detention centers well, and then they can also clear the waiting list. There are more than 10,000, and perhaps we can set up a closed camp for these refugees. I think this can be effective. We have submitted these proposals for a while. I hope the administration can tell us what is the conclusion of their consideration. Otherwise, if we cannot plug the loophole at source, there will continue to be swarms of refugees arriving, Ms. Ho. I think we have to sort out the facts first. When it comes to passing legislation to screen out the real refugees, whether it be the DAP or the Labour Party or the Democratic Party or the Civic Party, or our we voted on the same, and you lobbied us very hard for us to accept this mechanism. I didn't see any amendments. Now, if you really want to scope people, yes, you should also ask DAB members to step down. Well, the question of forced refugees is just an election issue. Yes, I think this will continue, because while once mentioned the possibility of withdrawing from CAT. Once we withdraw from CAT, then we don't have any mechanism to monitor the abuse of power by police officers and their torture of detained and arrested persons, because under this convention, there are procedures for people to seek refuge for protection against torture, but there are things to protect 7 million people in Hong Kong so that they will not be subject to torture or cruel and human treatment.
You
mentioned the IPCC just now, but the IPCC, the chairman, since Mr. Chek was taken away as chairman, the present chairman has changed his stance. How do you see IPCC in the past 2 years in monitoring the police? How do you see their performance, IPCC? Is it effective? As a civic body, what changes do you notice? Mr. Wang Hongyin? First of all, the Security Bureau branch will have to face a piece of reality, and that is since the change of guards at IPCC, there had been repeated notifications and sayings that the IPCC is no longer a independent monitoring body for the police. I think the government needs to follow up on this accusation. And secondly, the IPCC's terms of reference is in itself insufficient. It does not have investigative powers, and also the suggestions that it makes to the police is not strong enough. For example, they wanted to know more about the police actions and the guidelines for police actions. Their powers for getting the information is very limited. And the new chairman, after Mr. Chek,
is now even limiting more the powers of IPCC. In the past, where there are large-scale social movements or gatherings, let's say in the Yellow Umbrella or Occupy Central movement, the IPCC was slow in coming to the site, and before they would be more proactive. So it seems that they are retracting even more, and they're not sufficient in monitoring the police power. And in monitoring police power, the government should put in more resources to complete the system and perfect the system. I see a lot of victims not daring to lodge complaints because they fear that this will become, the evidence that they raise will become evidence that the police use in prosecuting them. With such an independent mechanism of the IPCC, how can victims and people be confident? This is exactly because it is not independent that there is this problem. Sin Chong Kai, Mr. Chair, I want to ask some questions about figures. I would like to thank all for coming up to the LegCo. Wherever you're coming from, I welcome your sharing of opinions. Mr. Lee, a question for you concerning statistics. This is a question for the administration. I don't have the hard copy. I'm looking at the PDF, page number 44. Which page are you seeing? 2015, January to May, applications number 107, and waiting for processing is 9884. And then in your document, in Appendix 3, again on figures, from March 2014 accumulated to now, awaiting processing applications number 11,000. My question is, from January to May in 2015, there were 9,884 awaiting. And what are the new cases from then till now? Mr. Sin asked about the figures, 2015, May, the number is 9884. For now, it is over or almost 12,000. Yes, I see the table. I'm talking about 2015. January to May, 9884. I mean post May 2016, starting from June, let's say, to now, how many additional new cases are there? For the entire year of 2015, there were we have received 5,053 cases. So we take away the 1,800 plus as of May of 2015, then the new cases would be 3,100 plus. As for this year, the first 4 months, it would be 1,500 plus cases. So every month there will be about 300 cases or 400 cases, is that right, new cases? Yes. Yes, we will be closing the meeting at 5:30 punctually, because the purpose of the meeting is really to allow the members to come up to voice their opinions. This will continue on Saturday. There will be others coming up, some 20 people from organizations or individuals coming up to share their opinions. And yes, there will be further discussions among members. Having heard their views, there will be further discussions also with the administration as well concerning the report. And I would like to thank again the 25 persons who have spoken, and individuals and representatives of organizations for sharing your opinions. I believe that this will be very important for us. It will elicit further thinking. on our side for the members, and also there is a very big team from the administration to listen to you, members who have come up. Thank you again for coming up to the LegCo. Yes, we will close the meeting here. Thank you very much for coming again. And next meeting will be Chair. Can we have a supplementary paper for the statistics? I mean, the statistics just now went up to May only. Can you have updated figures? Yes. The next meeting is the 11th of June, 9:15 to 11:15 this Saturday. Yes, thank you again. Thank you for coming. We close the meeting here.